Good morning. I am Jean-Louis Chameau. I'm the president of Caltech, and it's a great pleasure to welcome you this morning. I understand that this room is going to be filled in a very near future. We have more participants than we have seats, I believe. And this is why we are forcing you to be in the front here. And we know if it was a larger room, all of you would be in the back, like good students. So we try to make sure you are cozy and close to the front. We are delighted to have you here for this program on California as seen from space. Before I begin, I would like to recognize some of our special guests. I think there is Senator Liu who is here, Mayor Bill Bogart, I saw him. Over there, and Assemblyman Anthony Portantino will arrive fairly soon. I haven't seen him yet, but he will arrive fairly soon. And there are several members of their staff. There are also members of the staff of Dianne Feinstein, and I would like all of them to be recognized at this stage. So. Space is becoming a key vantage point for managing resources, protecting the environment, and supporting emergency response and preparedness. Being able to observe space, to observe Earth from space, can provide an assessment of both the global context of changes on Earth and the local and regional impacts of those changes. But transforming space-based observations and data into accessible and practical information is a major challenge. Practical means data that policymakers can use reliably in developing global treaties between nations or making long-term plans for water use in a region like the Western US, or even making real-time decisions at a local level when we are faced with disasters like the station fire a couple of weeks ago. The aim of this meeting today is to begin a conversation between researchers and policymakers on ways that Earth remote sensing can address such issues, with a focus, obviously, on regional context like California. This event today is made possible by the CAIC Foundation, without which the CAIC Institute for Space Studies, or KISS, would not exist. By the way, I would like to mention that Tom Prince, the director of KISS, is seated right there. The word unique is overused and often misused, but it is not an exaggeration in this case to say that KISS is a unique organization. As far as we know, it represents the first time a private foundation has invested its money for the benefit of the U.S. space program. This private funding allows KISS to explore ideas that are clever, out of the box, and possibly game-changing. It is difficult for federal agencies to support ideas that are not proven. The CAIC funding will allow KISS to do that and figure out which of those ideas may succeed and then propose them to the community and funding agencies. KISS is much more than a traditional think tank. In fact, it describes itself as a think and do tank. Those are not my words, okay? Because it requires that any brainstorming session it sponsors, like the one today, must be followed by seed funding for groundbreaking technical work. Caltech has a history of conducting high-risk research, not always in the mainstream, but high-risk also means potentially big returns that has a major impact on knowledge and innovation. KISS fits very well within this Caltech culture. Another important characteristic of KISS is that it was designed to bring together people from diverse disciplines and research cultures, people who might otherwise never have a chance to interact. So it is most appropriate that KISS has its home on the Caltech campus because we have a long history as a place where cross-disciplinary interactions is the rule rather than the exception. So this event today, where you will have an exchange of ideas between specialists in science and technology, leaders of state and local agencies, NGOs and commercial companies, I think it's going to be a good event for KISS to help translate scientific data to the benefit of society. And so it's also part of Caltech's mission. So I'm going now to let you start with your event. You have lots of things to cover, I understand, and you won't want to listen to me for too long. I will also apologize because it's an exciting event, but believe me, they keep me busy here, so I'm going to escape. So there is a front row seat here, which is very nice for the next person coming in. So I will not be able to join you. And I would like now to give the podium to Dr. Paul Weinberg, who will give you some background and discuss the goals of the workshop. I would like to mention that Paul is a faculty member at Caltech, but he's also the leader of the Lind Environmental Science Center at Caltech. The Lind Center, recently endowed by Ron and Maxine Lead, is a partner of KISS in this symposium. I wish you a very enjoyable and informative meeting.
Thank you, Jean-Lou. Diane Evans and I have had the honor of helping to put together today's program together, and we welcome you all to Caltech. So the population of California is projected to grow by 25 million people in the next 50 years. That's a 70% increase. Clearly, in the absence of significant changes in consumption, such growth will dramatically stress the state's water, land, and air. Even more challenging, Assembly Bill 32 envisions a future where we emit much less carbon to the atmosphere. Clearly, a call to business not as usual. Planning will be essential if we are to meet such challenges. In its absence, imagine a commute across Los Angeles with the population of Southern California double what it is today. So this is the context in which we meet today to ask how California can be transformed over the next 50 years to accommodate both this substantial increase in population while maintaining and hopefully even improving quality of life in its broadest sense. Clean water, vibrant communities and businesses, reduce seismic risks to our homes and infrastructures, a verdant environment. Also, of course, these changes don't occur in a vacuum. How will global climate change impact California? Can California continue to make progress on clean air while the global atmosphere becomes more polluted? Can we provide sufficient clean water while the population of the entire arid Southwest grows substantially? So even in, or especially in the presence of these uncertainties and questions, planning divorced from data is not wise. Our country, NASA, NOAA, and the taxpayers have invested heavily in the development and delivery of sensors from space that today monitor the global environment in exquisite detail. So how have and how do and how might these data provide for improved regional response and planning? So today's symposium brings together, as Jean-Lou mentioned, specialists in these observations, technical leaders at state and local agencies and NGOs, members of commercial resource and environmental companies to address this, the promise and impediments in translating observations to information that can inform. So the broad goal of today's conversation is to mutually inform to the data generators of the societal needs and of data consumers, the promise and the limitations of the observations obtained from space.